Bienvenue sur Beta Série La Radio pour un épisode d'Originals, l'émission dédiée aux séries qui font l'actu. Aujourd'hui, coup de projecteur et coup de cœur sur It's a Sin, une série sélectionnée au Festival de la télévision de Monte Carlo 2021, dont nous sommes partenaires médias. Nous avons déjà beaucoup parlé de It's a Sin en mars dernier, lors de sa sortie en France. Nous avons beaucoup apprécié cette fresque qui démarre en 1981 et se déroule sur toute une décennie dans la communauté gay de Londres, une communauté en pleine effervescence, mais aussi frappée durement par le sida et le regard de la société. Nous avons le plaisir d'accueillir aujourd'hui, le plaisir et l'honneur, d'accueillir Peter Orr, le réalisateur de tous ces épisodes et aussi de beaucoup d'autres séries également. Thank you so much to be with us today, Peter.
Thank you very much for having me.
So my first question is about you joining the show. When did you join It's a Sin? At its creation level, did you know its author, Russell T. Davies, or later on in its development?
Yes, much later on in its development, actually. I wasn't the first director on board, and sometimes jobs come that way, and you're excited, you grab them, you run with them. I had known Russell for about 15 years, met him in a nightclub when I was bothering him about Doctor Who, and he shouldn't have told me anything, but he did. And he's known me since then. The producer, Phil Collins, that I've known for like nearly 20 something years, never really properly worked with him. I was in a different department when he was producing back then. But anyway, I've sort of known everybody. They had a director. That relationship didn't work out. They were looking for somebody. There were 6 weeks left of pre-production, and I turn up and I'm like, this is brilliant, I love it. And they were like, well, you can do two episodes, that's okay, because there's not much prep left. But unfortunately, I was greedy and I said, can I have it all? And they were thrilled, because it obviously made a lot of sense to have one director on board. So that's it. I came on very late. I ran with it. It was Russell, so it wasn't a difficult decision for me to make, because it was so good. And but yeah, you know, what happened to the show, how big it's become, that I didn't see coming. I just knew that it was a good piece of television.
It was a very good intuition you had there. So you have directed effectively all these episodes of the series, and it's a series combining a powerful story. Russell T. Davies is incredible. I mean, he's a storyteller and an amazing storyteller. How did you collaborate? Because it's also a powerful rhythm, pictures, sounds, casting, it's a combination. So how did you collaborate with Russell to merge all these elements and to obtain such a successful mix?
Thank you. I mean, obviously that mix comes from many sources, like you say. There's casting, production design, director of photography, myself. And I think I am an intensely collaborative individual. So what I know from what I do is that if it's not right by the script, it's not right. So I've always been respectful of writers, and I think Russell has been around a long time, and I think he's probably had relationships with directors that did respect his work and directors that didn't. So I think, you know, you get to a point where you suddenly discover each other has each other's back, if that makes sense. And we discovered that. We worked very well together. I encouraged him to think a little bit more like me, and then he would make sure that I knew exactly how he was thinking. But really, I mean, all of the team were just stunning, and they had a directorial change very much at the last minute, and they were looking for answers, and I had to give them very, very quickly. But really, with Russell, talking about rhythm, you get a very specific rhythm with Russell. He writes a lot of scenes, a lot of bits, moments, brief things, and he's very surgical. Sounds a horrible thing, but there's no faff. He knows what he wants, and it's there on the page, and it's in and out. It was expensive sometimes to do these tiny little scenes in big locations, but I knew that I'd have something gold in the edit, because there's so much material. So really, it starts with him. I do it as precisely and as pointedly as he does. I added to the music that he'd already started writing in. And then I think just basically with layer upon layer upon layer, we just fitted it all together. I mean, it seemed easy at the time, but it just, you know.
We feel it's extremely collaborative, because it is so so well combined, and it's not the story doesn't prevail over the cynical elements. It's really a very good mix. I read, by the way, that Russell had initially of 8 episodes, you know, script in mind, whereas now it's reduced to 5. Did you take part to this decision or?
Not at all. No. When I arrived, it was 5. I actually got 4 when I first turned up. The 5th one was still being written. And as you know, if you've seen the show, the 5th one is quite an episode. So I was pitched what was happening. And so I knew that it was going to be a bit of a ride. But no, there was always 5. And I've been asked this a few times about the what if it was longer, or what would it have been, and how would it have been better? Would it have been able to spend more time? But I think honestly, one of the things I really like about it is that its brevity is one of its strengths, because these lives were taken so soon before you wanted them to go. You know, these wonderful, beautiful souls were taken from us. And that's the way it was. You know, they don't get the full 8 episodes in their lives. So I think it felt appropriate that this was an equally abrupt show in some ways, you know. And I think as well, there's an old adage, isn't there, about always leave them wanting more. So I think if we do that, then we sort of won. So I think it could have been 3 more hours of TV could have actually not.
Yeah, we're so sad to leave them, but as you say, it's dramatically, it's tragically true that their lives were so short. Yeah.
Yes.
And the story, speaking about the cast, the story is served by an exceptional and very charismatic cast. Mm. Not only Oli Alexander playing Richie, I would say the main character, but also the amazing Mary Douglas playing Roscoe, or the touching Lydia West playing Jill, actually a real person. I mean, inspiring Russell in this series. Did you have these actors in mind when preparing the shooting? Did you know all of them?
I didn't know any of them, actually. I think Lydia West was in Russell's mind from the start. They'd worked together on the years and years, and he adored her, and I could see why as soon as I met her. So, and she was, in a way, I mean, Oli had been doing it for a long time, but he'd also been a pop star for a while as well. So it had been a while since he'd done acting of this nature, and certainly held a show together. But Lydia had been working back to back ever since she came out of college, I think. So she almost became the most experienced person in the room, and she is still, like, you know, early 20s, but she was incredibly reliable and wonderful and warm, like you say. I had not met any of them. Andy Pryor, our casting director, really was responsible for all of that brilliance, because I mean, with Lydia, it's easy. We knew her, you know, where she had been before. With Oli, it was a stroke of genius, because we picked someone who not only could do it, he had a following, if it, like, you know, there was a presence for him, and these things matter as well in this world of modern TV. So I think we had a real, and he'd become very political is not the right word, but he'd become very sort of outspoken about his sexuality and about you know, homosexuality in general and rights and all of these things. So it felt like this was a perfect group. Mm-hmm. With the others, of course, Callum hadn't left college, so nobody really knew what was going to happen, other than if you ever meet Callum, you'll know that there's just this incredible energy and life force. So I think you just would be like, I want that on screen. And Amari and Nathaniel were also new to TV, but they had done theatre and whatever. So there's a lot of freshness. So I say I didn't know any of them. I was glad that we had all of them. That you would never have known, I think, if you'd been a casual observer, that they hadn't got the experience, because they were just so perfect. But I think that's what I wanted. I wanted them to be able to just go and do it and not worry about it. I didn't want them to care about technical stuff or, you know, whatever, shall I do this or whatever. I wanted them to just go for it. And then I'd sort of, you know, I'd pick them up if they fell, but they very rarely did. So
yeah, they're very professional, but we also feel a clear team spirit between them. Mm. So just like they knew each other for years. So this is why we feel this energy in this community, just like real friends. You are in a group of real friends. That's what you feel, you know. So A question about the musical soundtrack, which is very important in this show as it really identifies this decade. I think in particular of this exceptional musical sequence at the beginning of episode two, where Richie denies the AIDS pandemic. It's a musical, it's a real musical. Were these, hits already in the original script, or did you build the episode thinking of these hits of the music? How did you intricate both of them?
So Russell started with some of them. I mean, that particular sequence, while he denies the existence of the disease, that had a different track. And unfortunately, we didn't get the rights to that track. So I had actually imagined it and blocked it and shot it with that track being played throughout the entire thing. And then we had to change at the last minute. We actually changed in the edit, ended up with Sylvester, which I think was incredible, and also poignant for lots of other reasons. But that was always there. Russell had also included the Hooked on Classics sequence from the first episode, where there was a montage of joyous sex and that sort of casual abandon of like, oh, I'm young, I'm free, I'm sexy, I'm going for it. So these peppered the script. But I think really once I started getting into the world, and also we'd have to play things up on set just to keep, you know, when they were dancing or whatever, we'd play stuff in because, you know, a lot of the background cast hadn't been born, well, they were born this century, not the last. So we had to try and say, well, look, just this is the music of the time. So we'd play a lot of it in. And I think the more I did that, the more I thought, I want to see more of that. I want to hear more of it. So really through the cut, myself and my editor, we put stuff in as and when, and I'd just go through. I mean, sometimes I literally went and found it on Google as in to say, is it out yet? You know, because of the fact that it's a 10-year story, I would just go, is that track ready? Oh, yes, it just came out 2 months before this story. Right, good, put it in. And that's, it became a journey like that, really. And we just you know, kept that going. It seems to have taken a life of its own as well.
What influences did you have in series or movies to describe this decade and this community specific and very strong energy?
Influences. Mm. I had a few. There was actually, it's a long time I've had to think about this actually, but there was a French film about the creation of, is it ACT UP? BPM, the French film called BPM, is that right?
Yeah, yes. Battement par minute, the one that went to Cannes and won. Yeah,
utterly beautiful film. And before I had heard of it, I didn't know of it, and I certainly didn't know that something had been made that recently and have that impact. And it was wonderful. And I used that as a big influence in terms of the emotional sort of edge to it, the integrity, the authenticity. I mean, otherwise I was grabbing images from all sorts of different places, really, sort of like, you know, 80s movies and 80s aesthetics. But I mean, ultimately, what I wanted to make sure I didn't do was fall foul of the sort of wave of nostalgia. It's important that the period feels authentic, but I think sometimes you can overdo it, you know, and I didn't want to sort of, I wanted it to feel real, and I wanted it to feel honest. I wanted it to feel quite modern. So I definitely collected some references, but I think I got rid of them. Well, you never get rid of them. They're in the back of your head somewhere.
No, it's not a period drama. Yeah, it's not a period drama. We really fly over time, and we're right in the action, right in these years. It's really well done. Yeah.
Thank you.
A question maybe about you and your experience. You worked on many British series like Doctor Who, as you named before, and even it's a scene, it's quite a British show, it's even if it is it has an international distribution with HBO Max and then Starz Play and then or Canal Plus, it was initially commissioned by Channel 4. But I know you work also for Netflix as a director on Umbrella Academy or Altered Carbon. So is it different working for international OTT platforms? Have you changed your working habits? Is it really different, you know, from these British shows?
I don't think I've changed anything really. I've learned a lot from working in different places, certainly different countries. I've worked, even like working on a show called The Last Kingdom, which is now a Netflix show. I did the early series of that, and and I was shooting in Hungary and Budapest, and I just revel in all of it, to be absolutely honest. I think everyone has a slightly different way of doing it, but the basics are wonderfully the same. You know, across the whole world, we still make shows and films the same sort of way, and we understand the team, and we understand the collaboration, and the way that everyone has a job to do, and I think that's what's so wonderful. I mean, I there's always differences, there's probably too many to mention, but I don't think I've changed anything. I've just absorbed it as I went along, and hopefully that's put me in a good place to carry on and do more international work as well.
Yeah, you are really positioned on this growing segment in TV series, the high end and the series that can be global but circulate worldwide. So that's really an amazing period for you to have such challenges you can face. We are not so far, unfortunately, from the end of our interview, Peter. So as we know, there won't be a season two, unfortunately, of It's a Sin. On which new project are you currently working as a director or also as an executive producer? Or?
Well, I don't know. I think I don't know what I'm allowed to say at this actual point. I'm very lucky. After It's a Sin, I've been in contact with a number of incredible people who've all reached out because of the show and my involvement. So I am currently in a few development things. There's a couple of movies and a TV series that I'm talking with, but nothing's been, you know, greenlit or actioned in that way. And there is a little job for me coming up, which again, no one's announced, so I can't tell you. I've got a little episode in a TV series for a famous three-lettered broadcaster, which isn't the BBC. I'll let you do the rest, but I'm very excited by it, and its core story is something very, very akin to It's a Sin and my sensibilities, so I'm very glad that I'm able to do it, but all will be revealed soon, I'm hoping.
We'll be probably more than glad to welcome you back on Beta Series La Radio for your future shows then. So many thanks, Peter. It's short, but there are many other questions I would have be so happy to ask you, but we have to terminate. So many thanks. It was a very interesting discussion. Congrats again for this series and for jumping on board. Thank you. At the last minute and doing such a great integration with this amazing work from Russell. I switch back to French. So regardez It's a Sin. Vous serez totalement pris par l'énergie incroyable qui se dégage de ce groupe d'amis et touché par leur humanité et ce qu'ils vivent. N'oubliez pas de l'inscrire dans votre agenda Beta Série pour n'en rater aucun épisode et rendez-vous très bientôt pour une prochaine émission de Original sur Beta Série La Radio, partenaire média du Festival de télévision de Monte Carlo. Nous vous quittons sur la séquence musicale dont nous parlions tout à l'heure avec Peter, la séquence avec Richie qui fait un grand déni sur le sida, une séquence incroyable, digne d'une grande comédie musicale. À très bientôt en musique. Au revoir. Thank you so much.